Hello and welcome everyone to ACP's LinkedIn Live Inside Look series with Travelers. I'm Rich Comas, Senior Vice President and Chief of Staff. And in today's webinar, we're going to talk about how to maximize your LinkedIn presence, which has become super important in the job search process. But before we get into it, I want to talk a little bit about Travelers. Travelers is an insurance company that cares. And yeah, I can see it every day. They have been around for over 165 years, and they've earned a reputation to be one of the best property casualty insurers in the industry because they really do care for their customers. My personal experience with Travelers has been nothing but amazing. Everyone I encounter there definitely is a professional, and caring is definitely on their mind. They are huge supporters of the military community, have many, many veterans and military spouses employed there. They're one of our top suppliers of mentors. They've been with us for over 13 years, and they've mentored over 800 proteges throughout the years, which is pretty amazing. So I'm excited to get started. But first, I wanted to remind everyone that this will be recorded and that it'll remain on our LinkedIn so you can share it and watch it again. If you have any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat, and we'll get to them a little bit later in the broadcast. So now I'm going to introduce the panel real quick. We have Jim and Allison from Travelers, and we have Jennifer from very own ACP. So take it away, Allison.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for joining today, and thanks for having us. So like Rich said, and like you know why you're here, we're here to talk about some tips and tricks to have you better utilize LinkedIn wherever you are on your career journey. So just some quick intros. I'm Allison Joannis again. I'm a manager on the employer branding team at Travelers. So quickly overview about what I do is I help to market some of our opportunities at Travelers and what it's like to be a Travelers employee on social media and our careers website and so have you. So next, I'm joined by two other folks, as Rich said, so I'll throw it over to Jennifer to give a quick intro.
Hi, thank you, Allison. I'm Jennifer Williams. I'm an Army retiree. I served 22 and a half years in the military, primarily in public affairs. I also had roles in broadcasting and leadership. I'm also the communications manager here at ACP, so you'll probably see me on LinkedIn from time to time. And I'm also a very proud ACP alumna. So this program is near and dear to my heart, and I'm happy to share my tips about the mentorship program as well as LinkedIn. So I'll toss it to you, Jim.
Jim, you're on mute.
Of course I'm on mute. Thanks, Rich. We utilized, as the intro slide, you know, our LinkedIn profiles with QR codes. So you know, please just connect with all of us. LinkedIn is just such a powerful tool for each and every one of us. I'm Jim McMahon. I'm with Travelers. I coordinate military and veteran outreach for the company. And as Rich said, we've been a great partner with ACP for 12, 13 years, and I co-manage that program. So just very briefly, Travelers, who are we? What are we? We're a property and casualty business. And you know what? When I get in front of a military audience, I'm always saying, insurance is risk management. Everyone in the military is trained at risk. And that's the complementary cultures, I think. Just very briefly, we know we've got about 1,000 military veterans in the company. We also have a very, very strong internal military network that numbers about 3,200, includes military spouses, family members, friends, and we're very active in the community. And that's our group that right now we have about 100 of our military network members that are mentoring through ACP. So it's a great partnership. And anytime I'm talking to military audiences on how do you evaluate a potential employer, it's what do they do for the community? And you know, we're really proud of our community connections, but that's one of the things you can absolutely find out on LinkedIn. You know, not only what is Travelers involved with, but what are the other partners of ACP getting involved with? Who's doing some different things? So I'm going to turn it back to Allison, and we're going to spend the next 30 to 40 minutes or so getting a great overview of how to really utilize LinkedIn from an insider's perspective.
Thanks, Jim. All right, so let's get into it. So yeah, as Jim said, as Rich said, we're here to talk about LinkedIn, right? And how you can kind of develop or sustain your overall professional presence on LinkedIn for wherever you are in your career journey, like I said. So a couple of other little housekeeping things. If you have the ability, whether it's on your phone or on another screen, or even kind of toggling between both screens or both different windows, I definitely recommend you to open your LinkedIn. Some of the training you can be walking through might help to kind of drum up some questions as well. So definitely would recommend that you go ahead and do that. Another point of housekeeping, just want to let you know that the majority of this training is really focused on the free version of LinkedIn, right? Unless I indicate otherwise that it's kind of part of the premium feature. If you don't know, which I'm assuming you probably do, our military members, veterans, and their families are provided a 1-year free on LinkedIn Premium. So that's something that you could take advantage of. Of course, I work for Travelers, not LinkedIn, so I'm not an advocate either way, but I do want you to know that it is something, and there are some additional features available. So I think there might be a link that we can put in the chat, and if not, we can add it throughout the training where you can go and kind of validate yourself in as a military member or military family member. So just a note on that. But wherever you are in your career journey, whether you're transitioning, you're about to transition, you're a mentor, you're already well into a career, you've already transitioned, or you're really just here from the standpoint of helping transitioning service members, right? You've got a professional network that you've created and you've grown over the years or over the time in whatever career, whether it's military or civilian, you've got this network. So our stance really in LinkedIn stance is the more that you understand and you're aware of how to engage with that network on social media, whether it's LinkedIn or other platforms that you're interested in, it's going to give you that professional edge, right? You know, you're here, you want to get some of those tips and tricks. So that's why we're here in a sense to really kind of give you some of those tools that you could utilize LinkedIn from transition all the way well into growing your career. So a couple of questions that we always encourage folks to go ahead and ask themselves, right, is to kind of establish where you are and what you want to get out of LinkedIn at this particular time. And I'll probably refer back to these a couple of times throughout the training. And the questions really, really lead directly to some of the stuff that we're going to talk about, our agenda in a sense there in the right? So why are you here today, right? Why are you hoping to gain a presence on LinkedIn? We're going to talk a little bit about your profile, and you kind of think of as you update their profile, what you're hoping to get out of LinkedIn, who you're trying to attract to your profile. On that note, right, networking on LinkedIn, building that valuable network. Who is going to add that value to your network, whether it be now and whether it be in the future, right? And committing to sustaining, right, your professional brand on LinkedIn, your profile on LinkedIn. That's going to be a lot about content. Once you kind of begin those building blocks of building the network, getting your profile updated, it's going to be a lot about sharing the content to keep your profile active. And how can you encourage others to do the same, right? Perhaps you've got someone that couldn't make it today, right? Make sure you share some of these tips and tricks, right? Share the recording out onto your LinkedIn channel. That could be a great post, right, to start out on. So your colleagues, your fellow military members who are in similar positions or are heading that direction, they can acquire these tips as well. So we're going to jump into the profile basics first, right? And we're going to talk, it says four, there's a little bit more built into there, but these are the four basics that when you sign up for LinkedIn and you get your profile, they're there for you, right? They're there, and LinkedIn kind of views these items as complete profiles, right? So we're going to talk about each of these in depth. And why is it important that we make sure that we've got our profile kind of populated on LinkedIn? It's because looking at LinkedIn profiles is a number one activity on LinkedIn. This is what we're all doing, right? The name of the game is really networking on LinkedIn, but without those really great profiles, folks have got nothing to look at, nothing to learn about you. So it's really a first step in making sure that you're establishing your kind of professional brand or presence on LinkedIn. The more information you've got on there, the more traffic, the more exposure your page is going to get, the more connections you're going to get. And you'll kind of see that echoed throughout the training. LinkedIn, as a general rule of thumb, favors populated profiles. It's kind of a tongue twister there. So you're going to come up in searches. People are going to be more likely to click on when they see the some of this this information filled out on your page. Something I also want to just kind of draw attention to on this slide, and I believe the next one, those notification settings at the bottom, that right there really just links to the top of your profile. If you go up to me, if you're in LinkedIn, down up on the top right-hand corner, drop that down, you'll see kind of the settings function, and you can click in there, and there's different visibility settings that you have access to. We'll talk a little bit more about privacy in a bit, but there's visibility settings that you can adjust so people know when you're looking at their profile, when they are, or when you're making changes to your profile. So just want to call attention to that there. So the extras though, right? So we've talked about those kind of high level and we'll get into them more, but there's a couple of ones that I wanted to add that are extra modules that you can add, if you will, to your profile, just given the audience. I thought they were really great call out. So as I said, when you join LinkedIn, when you have your LinkedIn profile, the four or five things that we talked about or showed you previously, those are automatically there. But there's all kinds of other modules that you can add. How you find them is you go to view your profile and you'll see that add profile section. Couple I just want to call out here, career breaks, licenses and certifications, courses, honors and awards, right? Career breaks is a fairly new function on LinkedIn. It allows you to indicate breaks in your career, breaks in your employment, in your experience section on LinkedIn. Well, I think that's really great. Kind of came about after COVID, but it's really great because it gives you the opportunity to explain why you might have a break in employment. And, you know, Jim could add some color to this, right? It's something that we talk to recruiters about now, particularly with the military, for the military applicants, right? To kind of understand that. This kind of gives you the opportunity to explain not only what the break in career was, but also to kind of think outside the box and think about some of the skills you might have acquired while you were kind of on that career break. And the other three are pretty, oh, can you go back one second? Yep. And the other three are pretty straightforward, right? Licenses and certification courses in your military career, certainly you're acquiring some of those certifications, you're attending different courses. Education, right, is a little bit different than what it's like in the civilian world. That's an opportunity to indicate that as well. And honors and awards is pretty straightforward. So those are just some things to think about. Last one here I just want to call attention to is the open to work. If you go to I want to, right, next to the add profiles section there, you can add the open to work. That's kind of like a beacon. You have the opportunity to add that profile frame that says open to work. It's kind of like a beacon for the recruiters out there to see that you are actively looking for a role on LinkedIn. All right. So now kind of getting into those four basic building blocks, right? So we've got your banner photo and profile photo. So we'll start right up at the top at the banner. Don't skip this one. You have that LinkedIn blue banner up there, but this is an opportunity to kind of add a little bit of personality and creativity to your profile. It also can indicate where you are in terms of location. Really popular ones to choose from are landscapes and cityscapes. Also thinking about adding photos that indicate the industry that you're interested in entering into or industry that you're currently in, or really just something that's kind of fun and creative. We always like to tell people that, you know, while LinkedIn is a professional presence, doesn't mean that it has to be a boring one, right? It's a great place to add some creativity and some personality or profile. Great place to show pride and service if that's something you want to indicate on your profile as well. Your profile photo, definitely don't skip this one as well. I see a lot of people out there skipping it. Recommended from kind of that military perspective that you've got a civilian photo, thinking about the world you're trying to enter in. Also, though, I see a lot of people toggle between a professional civilian photo and a military photo, depending on the time of year, right? But in terms of kind of the job search, right? Recommend you do a non-uniform photo. Make sure it's good resolution, right? It's not grainy. You're taking up the majority of the frame. Does not have to be a headshot. Can be a photo your family member took of you or a friend took of you. It can even be a selfie, but the recommendation with something like that is you make sure you're zoomed in so it's not as obvious that you're taking the photo yourself. So next down is the first kind of words people are going to see on your profile, right? So if you were to go and search contacts on LinkedIn, you're going to see a list and you're going to see the photos and you're going to see the headline and location right at the top. So these are really important things that even if right now you can kind of complete these, that would be, you're off to a really great start, right? So what does your headline indicate or what is included there, right? Basically asking the question, why am I here and what do I want? So from kind of that job search perspective, right, looking at the example there, that's a really great example, who you are and what you're looking for, right? What is the industry you're trying to get into? Perhaps there, right, it indicates kind of the military role, but perhaps that one is pretty obvious and straightforward. Perhaps yours might require a little bit additional definition from a civilian employer standpoint. So important to kind of incorporate a both those marketable skills that you have that you might be trying to attract folks, recruiters who are out there looking for specific types of skills to match them to different roles. Totally up to you if you want to indicate here that you are a veteran or you are a member of the military or you are transitioning out. You have about 220 characters, I believe. So it's a one or two very short sentences. I also see a lot, like you see in Christian's example too, folks that are using that text separator, which is also a great way to list out some of those marketable skills that you might want to get out there. Keeping in mind that, like I said, when folks are searching, not only are these skills going to come up in a search or these words that you're indicating at the top of your profile, they're, I think, really are kind of like the signpost. It's what going to get people to click on your profile. Oh, this person has skills that I'm looking for. Or this person is similar to me. I want to make the connection. So great to include and think of it in that way. And is also another really great way or great reason to look at other people's profiles. It gives you ideas for your own. Last but not least, your location. Just making sure that you're including your location as well. From a location standpoint, understanding that a lot of the audience on this call might not be in your permanent location. You might not be in the location you want to find employment in. So you can put the location you're headed towards as well. So kind of thinking about it in those terms, because the location, and as I said with the skills, it's kind of matching up to LinkedIn's algorithms, and it's going to be matching you with folks who are in similar industries, in similar circumstances, in similar locations. So if you're looking for a job in Atlanta, Georgia, but you are in New York, list your location where you want to find employment. All right, so creating your custom URL. So if you've been on LinkedIn for a while or if you can check really quickly right now, and you go and view your profile, the URL at the top, it might be kind of a random jumble of numbers and letters, right? LinkedIn assigns you a random URL, but you can, and we highly recommend that you do customize it. You can follow these little steps here. Always looking for the pencil, contact info, pencil, edit, and then you can go ahead. We recommend that you make it unique to you, right? Your name is an obvious one. If it does make you have numbers, we would recommend that you make those numbers also unique to you. I always just say it's really great so you can remember what your URL is. I type in my URL all the time just for a quick way to get to my profile. But this is a URL that would be great to add to your resume as well. So that's another really great reason to make sure this is customized, because it's great to add to your resume. So next down, so I would say, right, the things that we just talked about are priority, right? The summary and experience we're going to talk about now might take a little bit more time, a little bit more work, and a little bit more thought, right? So your summary, in a sense, is your elevator pitch, right? You have 220 characters in the headline. You might want to explain more, but your summary is going to be, can you go back just one? Go back one slide, please. Oh, thank you. Perfect. So your summary is really going to be able to expand on those skills, right? Talk about your experience, highlight your skills, your areas of expertise, certainly employment, whether military or otherwise, indicate that here. It's really just a great place to kind of bring who you are as a professional to life, right? including, again, accomplishments, right? Incorporating your personality, as I said before, let that echo throughout your profile. Like Jim was talking about, you're out there looking for companies that share your values. What are those values, right? So companies who are looking for you know, hey, this person is really interested in that community involvement, in that volunteerism. That's a really great kind of topic to discuss with them in terms of employment. It's written in a first person, so not like a military bio, right? And if you've got that military bio, great. You could certainly pull from it and add it here, but you want to talk in the first person perspective, kind of an introduction to who you are. A note on premium here, I just wanted to let you know, this is a sort of a new feature. I was told by LinkedIn it'll be out for everybody after October, but not something I've checked on. AI will write your summary for you now. So if you are utilizing the premium function, just to let you know, make sure you keep your eye out for that. I have seen it kind of work in action and it seems pretty cool. But the one thing that you do have to work on to get that to work is to have the really great experience section, which we're going to talk about right now. So your experience section, right, is your resume, right? In a sense. Almost. Okay. It's the area of LinkedIn where you're going to indicate your employment experiences, different jobs, different positions that you've held, right? Listing them all out. You can do them in chronological order, or as you can see there, it can be kind of that functional format, what you want on top, because the dates will all be there, right? So including the employment, including the roles, some of those bullet points that showcase some of the specific accomplishments. Most of us in the corporate world, right? When we love to see data, right? You know, indicating how many people you've managed or things that you accomplished, right? What's really great about the experience section on LinkedIn, it's less limited than your resume, right? Your resume really is tailored to the specific job that's attached to. But your LinkedIn experience section has it all. So that's where you could start from. And then your resumes can get built off of that experience section on LinkedIn, right? So that's kind of the biggest difference, I would say. I think we've all been in a situation where we're staring at our resume and thinking, wow, I really want to include all these bullets on this resume, but I really do have to prioritize. Well, your LinkedIn experience section is where you don't have to necessarily prioritize every single word. You've got a lot of space to include. And that's why it's great to have your LinkedIn URL on your resume. So folks like Jim or other recruiters out there in the world can click on your LinkedIn link and kind of get that whole picture. The other great thing about this section is you can add URLs and photos or videos. So me and Jennifer, we're in, and even Jim, right? We're in sort of that marketing world where there might be really great content that supports our work. You might not be in that place, but again, think outside the box here, right? Perhaps you were quoted in an article, you know, about training or an event, right? Maybe you share that here. Maybe there's other items out there that support the work that you've done, whether it's military related, whether it's civilian. So think outside the box of different URLs or photos or videos that you could kind of add to show color to who you are as a professional and some of the work that you've been involved with. Jim or Jen, do you guys have anything that you want to add kind of from the experience section? You know, things to include, things to keep to the resume, keep to experience?
Well, I was just going to say, just from a veteran standpoint, that if you did use a picture of you in uniform, it's okay. There's not going to be points against you. My first photo on LinkedIn was me in my dress uniform. I was really proud of it. And then after, you know, learning more about it, I was like, oh, you know what? That's probably not showing where I'm going. So then I cropped it to just my, you know, collar up, and then later, you know, got a professional photo. So my advice is, yeah, definitely you want a photo that reflects where you're headed, right? So if you do have the military photo, don't worry, switch it up. And then the other thing I'd like to say is that if you're worried about the tailored or customized URL, you can change that. You can update that. So don't feel like once you lock it in, it's locked in forever. I can tell you I've changed my customized URL a couple of times, and it's really simple to do. So these are all things that while they may seem overwhelming initially, it's okay to make updates because it's a process, and it's normal and natural to have updates because you're going to progress in your career. So don't worry that you're making too many. I don't think that's a thing.
I would agree, and I'm glad that you said that, because at all of these things on the LinkedIn profile, it's so easy. You can change it every day, right? From, we're going to talk about privacy settings in a second, but from those visibility settings to your headline, you can change it every day. Your photo, you can change it back and forth. I think in my experience working with the tool, it's super easy to kind of change your mind and go back. So none of it is ever set in stone, and it's totally a process.
Yeah, from my perspective, I'm actually going to comment a couple of slides ago. The career breaks are great for military spouses. I see so many resumes come in from military spouses and concern about, like, literally hiding the fact that you're a military spouse. Find a company that you don't have to hide that from, celebrate it, and just explain. You know, when you're on a career break, you're probably taking some school or you're volunteering. There's very valuable experience you're learning. So, you know, take advantage of that. And the banner open to work, that actually works. I am always attracted when I see open to work. I'm the recruiter in me. Who are you? Where are you? You know, what's your background? So it's a great way to just highlight, you know, if you're on the career search, for folks out there that are going to be able to help you out.
Awesome. All right. So now we're going to talk about networking next, right? And so as I promised, right, we'll mention some privacy settings, right? So in the same place as mentioned kind of the visibility settings, you'll also see where all of your privacy settings are. From kind of the recruitment out there job searching perspective, we definitely recommend that you make yourself as available and open as possible. Also, just like we said, right, Jennifer pointed out, these are settings that can be changed at any time based on your comfort level, right? Current events, understanding, right? Particularly with this group, there could be additional sensitivity there. Knowing a little bit about some of the training that you get before you exit the military on social media, right? Understanding that kind of heightened level safety security might change, like to your personal discretion. So to Jen's point, definitely get in there, check out what all these settings are, turn on things, turn off things when you're comfortable. But from that job search perspective, we want to make sure that people can find you and connect with you rather easily. And then it'll be kind of your responsibility, and we'll talk on this next slide here, about kind of being that gatekeeper, right? To being kind of looking at people's profiles and deciding whether you're going to connect with them, which might also indicate you're going to share more information with them. So growing that network, right? So as I said, right, we in the kind of job search from that standpoint or networking, we'll make ourselves open as possible that we're comfortable with, and share as much as we're comfortable with, kind of, again, understanding that people who send you requests are never going to get that kind of ignored from you or anything like that. So it's completely up to you, and would totally recommend that when folks send you those requests, check out their profile and decide if it's someone that's going to add value. And who's going to add value? Like I was saying before, it's folks that who are perhaps in a similar, under similar circumstances in you, folks that are hiring, right? So companies that are hiring, perhaps folks that work at those companies that you're really interested in working for. We provide kind of training like this internally at Travelers, and we encourage our employees to get out there and grow their own professional networks for the purpose of communicating with folks like yourselves who might be interested in working at Travelers or whichever company you're interested in. So growing that valuable network, really easy ways to do that would be, first and foremost, get out there and follow different influencers and companies, relevant hashtags, things that are specific to you, industries that you want to get into. So there's tons of groups out there that will kind of open you up to other folks who are in that group who would be really potentially great contacts for you, right? How are you going to find those is really that search bar on the top, as you can see in the example here. I just searched American Corporate Partners. And as you see, all those buttons at the top are filters. So you can select any of those. I have the people selected. And you can see that Jennifer is the first person that pops up, right? She indicates she works for American Corporate Partners right in her headline. So that's how I was talking about kind of those search terms and how they really kind of pull from that information on your profile. And then if I were to click down, right, groups, we'd see Connect, companies, we'd see American Corporate Partners, right? And then you can kind of see posts, so you can see what other people are talking about, and perhaps that content is relevant to you. That's a really great way to kind of build a connection. Jen, do you want to talk a little bit about some of the content, you know, that you're putting out there, or the folks that you're engaging with in, you know, in the Connect group or on the ACP page?
Absolutely. So definitely when you're building your network, I know when you're starting out, this can seem really overwhelming. And so there are some kind of simple things you can do to start growing your network in a way that's kind of easy and, you know, very simple. So one of the things I wanted to say was, if there are companies that you're interested in or you'd like to know more about, you can actually follow companies. And once you do that, you know, LinkedIn will actually show you other people with like similarities who also follow that company. So that could be someone that you reach out to make a connection. The other recommendation I'd like to make is joining groups. So groups within LinkedIn are like kind of like groups with like-minded interests, right? So ACP has a group. It's called ACP Connects, and you can request to join it. The nice thing about ACP Connects is that once you're in, you know, you can find all kinds of opportunities. So there might be hiring posts. There could be someone giving opportunities about scholarships, internships, skill bridge programs. I mean, they're basically lots of different resources, and it's very military friendly. So, and that's another place where you could go. You could learn a lot about different organizations and companies. You could get to know other people who are also there doing the same thing as you, trying to figure out your next steps, right? And, you know, and that's something that you could just reach out to people through the group and build your connections there. So I think those are like two really simple ways to get started. The other thing I would say is to look out for people such as myself, that if you send me a connection request and you say, hi, I'm a fellow veteran, I'm a military spouse, I'm part of the military community, I'm going to accept that request, right? Please don't be shy. I'm not. So if you are having trouble, just send it brief note. Hey, I'm also military connected, accept. And then from there, you can reach out anytime if you have questions. So I'm not the only one. There are many other people out there like me, and you could probably meet them in a group or by following another company.
Totally. Yeah. And just last thing, you don't have to go back though, but using the other folks' connections, right? So you connect with, say, Jennifer, right? You connect with Jim, or you connect with me. Click on our connections at the bottom when you see go on other people's profiles. That's another great way, kind of like Jennifer was saying, to say, okay, I connected with Jennifer. There might be tons of other folks that she's connected with, that she's connected with kind of over time, right? That could also add value, that are similar to Jennifer in similar positions or similar to other folks. And it's also a really great way to kind of build your profile or your network as well.
Yeah, and I'll add, when you're first starting out, this could be intimidating. I mean, if you see people that have thousands of connections and you're wondering, like, how am I ever going to get there? I love from a games perspective. So 5, 6, 7 years ago, I would set a goal of I'm going to just take, you know, a half hour once a week, and I'm going to find 25 people and I'm going to send them connection requests. And then I would track, you know, I first started out with like, okay, if 10 of the 25 accept, you know, that's a successful week for me. And then customize the messaging a little bit. And then it was like, okay, 10's not enough. I want to get 20 out of 25. If you need to do that to just kind of give yourself some short-term goals, you will be amazed at how quickly you will build up your network. And then you will start getting at a lot of connection requests. The more visible you are, you don't have to be the one initiating the action all the time. You will sit back and like, oh, why does this person want to connect with me? I think you'll really be surprised at how quickly you can build a really robust professional network.
Absolutely. And having that populated profile and information and kind of getting content and engaging helps, because LinkedIn does, I think, Jennifer, you made the point, LinkedIn does some of the work for you and will help to match you with people based on some of the information that you're indicating. And also to Jennifer's point, right, the note, right? I think you're going to realize when people start coming to you and asking to connect with you, you're going to see how much you value getting a note, kind of the why that they want to reach out and connect with you. So definitely make that a practice as well. Shooting that quick note to someone and indicate why you want to connect with them. And it can be as simple as, I'm also in the military community. I'm also transitioning. I'm curious about, you know, X, Y, and Z. So the example here too is that commonality, and always whatever that commonality is, and that's just in networking in general, an easy way to always start a conversation is finding that kind of common ground. Really easy way, even if it's a person kind of common connection, to just send a note and indicate why you want to connect. So it always kind of just helps that other person on the other end to feel a little bit more comfortable and hit accept. So using the app, so definitely, I know I mentioned it earlier, you know, if you're following along on LinkedIn and your app right now, definitely recommend that you get it, even if it's for temporary, you have it for a time, you delete it for a time, because it's going to help you more or less sustain your presence on LinkedIn, right? We'll talk about content in a second. But even if you have it, you turn on your notifications, so you're kind of on top of all the connection requests that you might be getting, whether you're going to accept or ignore. You can also make those really fast profile updates, right? Whether it be the privacy settings or, hey, I just thought of this really great idea. I want to add this to my headline. You can do all that from the app. So definitely a really great way to stay engaged on LinkedIn. This little tool that they've added in the past couple of years is also something that I get a lot of positive feedback. It's like the new business card, right? So LinkedIn will provide a QR code that directs right to your LinkedIn profile. So you're having a quick conversation with somebody, but you want to make sure that you connect. You can grab this QR code and they can kind of hover over and connect, or even more simply, you can just kind of rattle off your URL because you remember it. Where do you get this on your app, right? You see, you'll click on My Network, you'll find the blue person, and then you'll see the QR code option. The other way that you, if you don't have this option here, you can click into the or tap into the search bar right at the top, and you'll see kind of a little QR code kind of graphic pop up, and you can go ahead and click on that. So we get a lot of great feedback with these folks going to events, but it's not just events too, right? We know that we make network connections in person all over the place, right? It could be at the coffee shop. It could be dropping your kids off to school. It could be any of those things. So definitely something to know that you can quite literally have in your back pocket. And then content, as I said. So, right, so if you've got the app or even if you don't and you kind of are making an active effort, right, to sustain your presence on LinkedIn, you're really happy with your profile or you're happy with it today and you might change it tomorrow, you're building on your network. The last kind of piece of the puzzle on LinkedIn in terms of sustaining your presence is to share content or engage with content on a regular basis, right, a couple of times a week. That doesn't mean that you have to create new content every day that's original to you, just getting out there and kind of engaging with what you see in the feed. If you're following the companies that you're interested in and you've joined groups and you've connected with those like-minded folks that are in similar circumstances or folks that you're kind of aspiring to be in terms of career, you're going to be seeing all of that really relevant content to you on your feed. So you're going to find it pretty easy to get on there and like, share, comment on some of the things that they're putting out there. When you're adding kind of commentary or a caption to whatever you're sharing, similar to before, right? It's professional, but it can be casual, right? And kind of answering the question I always tell people to ask themselves is, why do I want my network to see this? Why is it important to me? Adding some of those hashtags that you might be following will open up the reach to more folks who might be following or following that hashtag, or tagging companies, tagging colleagues, again, are going to open the reach to your content being seen by more people, which is in turn going to lead to more of those network connections. So more or less, right, your authentic voice, like I said, professional, but yourself, you're speaking and keeping it casual. Definitely include photos and videos. I very rarely see folks posting content that doesn't have any kind of visual anymore and would definitely get lost. So keep that in mind. And those opportunities for reciprocity, like I said, the more that you're engaging with the content that you see on your feed, the more your connections are going to do it for you. And so we've just got some examples here, some travelers content, military related content or career content, and certainly hopefully you're requesting to join into the ACP Connects group or following along with ACP as well. These are all really great content examples to engage with. Anything you want to add from a content perspective, Jen?
Yes, I'll say that sometimes this is another area where transitioning military spouses feel conscientious. You know, they're kind of shy or maybe a little bit intimidated by sharing content. And the thing is, everyone is allowed to share their experience. Even if you don't, if you see some content that speaks to you, it's great to comment on it, share it, whatever, and just add, even if it's something like, wow, I never knew this before, it's okay to say that, because it's actually, people really want to help fill in the blanks for you, right? So if you say, oh, I didn't really know much about this, or hey, I'm trying to learn more about this, it's amazing how people step up and try to fill in those blanks for you. So that's a very easy way to start engaging with content. So just keep it simple. Say what you liked about it. You don't have to go really deeply in depth. Just say what was great about it. Or if you found something interesting that you didn't know, it's okay to say that too. And it's kind of like baby steps. And once you start doing that, it kind of picks up from there. So that would be my recommendation, is to just kind of like take a deep breath, you know, make a comment, do a repost, and then see what happens. It'll probably be a good thing.
And there's a lot of artificial intelligence. There's a lot of content direction. So if Jennifer posts something and I like it, and I mean, when I say I like it, I check, I like it, and I make a comment on it. The system reads that and then will deliver more content from Jennifer to me or something similar. So again, as you're sitting here, you know, it's, we get it all the time. You know, you click on one ad and you get seven more ads that look like it. If you click on one thing on ACP that you genuinely like, yeah, because there's just tons of comment. I'm always like, God, how did I find that? And I wish I could get more of that. Engage, click like, put a comment on it, and the system will deliver more things, you know, very similar to you.
Totally, right. And then those are those baby steps, right? Like I was saying, posting frequently doesn't mean create an original post five times a week. Really just get on there and like a few things. And kind of like Jim and Jen were saying, LinkedIn will do some of the work for you. And last but not least, measuring success. So we threw this one in and we can add that the link to the social selling index in the chat. Definitely click on it. You have to be logged into your LinkedIn for this to work, but LinkedIn will give you a score. And a lot of times when I present this on a training and people are not muted, I hear, you know, little grumblings, right? Really the idea is to kind of see where you are today and kind of apply some of what we talked about today and see where you are next week, or giving yourself that timeline and see where you're, if your score has adjusted in the next month after you kind of make an effort to build your network and update your profile, right? And as we've kind of been saying, it is a process, right? My score goes up and down as well, right? A week or two ago, Jim and I were looking at this together, and Jim's score is one of very good, right? And I was looking at mine thinking, oh boy, it's a little bit lower than it's been. I better kind of get out there. And really just kind of 1 week of making a few little adjustments and sharing more and engaging more, and the score grows, right? So kind of this just, it kind of grades you based on your profile, your general activity, relationship building, building your network, and like I said, kind of getting out there and being engaged. I think what also is great about it, and to keep in mind, if you're looking at your score right now and it's not what you want to see, it is 1 through 100 or 200 rather, but 70 to 75 is kind of the sweet spot recommendation from LinkedIn. And also, as you can see, if you're looking at it now or if you're not, up at the top, it kind of measures you against your network and your industry, which I think is also really notable too, right? Because you can kind of see, oh, these people I'm connected with, these people are sort of similar to me. I'm in a really good percentile, even though my score isn't kind of what that LinkedIn recommendation. So it's something to just kind of keep a watch and see how you improve over time, and or set that reminder, like I said, with me thinking, oh, I've been pretty lazy on LinkedIn. I can see that my score is dropping. So it's just kind of a fun thing to kind of measure your success over time.
The other thing, as far as the score, like on your profile, LinkedIn will deliver like your profile is 60% complete. Or 70% complete or 95% complete. And it'll tell you areas to focus in on to make it more attractive, to make it more discoverable. But this isn't a competition. So don't feel like you have to go get 100%, you know, profile by 6 o'clock tonight, or, you know, your score. It's go back to that very beginning slide where Allison was saying, what do you want to get out of LinkedIn? Right. And gauge your activity, gauge your, you know, involvement based on what you want to get out of it. But there are a lot of tools that if you really do want to utilize LinkedIn to increase your network, to potentially find a job, you know, follow along. And if it says it's, you know, your profile is 60% complete, look at the areas that you can, you know, you can either add to or supplement to get your score a little higher. Use it as a learning tool, not as a competitive tool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're all on kind of the journey. Like I said, you know, even me and Jim and Jennifer, as we're in LinkedIn frequently, you know, it's going up and down and up and down. So with that, I think we're going to open it up to questions.
Yeah, so thank you so much. That was great. Learned a lot. And for those of you that are in the transition process, this is definitely something you should take seriously. I think that if you don't have a LinkedIn profile, that step one is to get one and start filling it out like these, like some of these tips we've had today, because I think it really does make a difference. People do take a look at you and try to get a sense of who you are based on that. So it really behooves you to do it right. We do have a few questions that came up throughout. So I'm going to go ahead and bring those up as we go. We'll try to answer them pretty quickly, but someone asked, Keisha actually asked, what type of content should they write on their profiles? Or, you know, are we meant to write on our profiles? So I don't know if you want to talk a little bit more, you know, should you be, I guess, I think her point maybe is like, should you be kind of begging for a job or letting people know I'm available, or what's the right tone maybe?
Jim, I'll throw that one to you.
Yes, is my answer. If you're looking for a job, tell me you're looking for a job. It's view it as a positive, not as a negative. I'll give you an example. A year or so ago, I posted something. I don't remember what I posted, and somebody liked it. And I am super competitive, so I look at it like, okay, who liked it? And there was one particular person who was like, I don't know who this person is. I clicked on it. It was a military spouse, and she had the banner open to work. And then she also listed her location as St. Paul, Minnesota. And guess what? Our second largest office is in St. Paul, Minnesota. And we love the military community. We love military spouses. And she was not connected to me directly. We were like a second connection. And Allison, I don't think you explained first connection, second connections. If we have time, you know, maybe you go do that. And I just sent her a LinkedIn connection request. I said, hey, thanks for liking my comment. I see you're in St. Paul. I see you're open to work. Let's talk. She just celebrated her 1-year anniversary with us. It works, right? So, you know, these success stories, this is not mythical that we're presenting to you. They really can work for you.
That's a good point. Yeah, Allison, I think it is probably helpful to mention the first, second, third sure. connection. And I think how that relates to when you like or comment and all that stuff.
Yeah. So kind of going back to looking at connections, if you're searching folks or you're looking at a list on a group, you're going to see one, first, second, third. A first connection means you're connected with a person. Second means they're a connection of a connection. So if you think about it, like in first cousins once removed, it's kind of like that. How far away is the person, right? So, and if it's a third, they're a connection of your connection's connection, kind of something along the line. So it's kind of how far away they are from you. So, you know, if you click on someone, like Jim said, that liked your commented or liked something and they're a second connection, you're not connected with them. So you might want to learn a little bit more about them to connect with them. And that second indicates that you have a common person. So that's a great way to kind of find that common ground.
And can you explain, I think I get it, but why did that woman even get the opportunity to see Jim's comment? Because she wasn't connected to him.
Because that's really kind of how we're talking about tagging or hashtagging. That's one way, right? It expands your content to a wider audience than the folks that you're actually connected with. Another way too is if you're posting in groups, then more folks who are you're not directly connected with are able to see those pieces of content that are put out there. Or if someone that Jim is connected to shared it or liked it, then his feed is going to see that engagement. So the more you're engaging out there and liking and commenting, and the more people are kind of doing that with your content, just keeps expanding your reach outside of your network.
I think that's important. When you like something, you're now kind of giving your network access to it. As Jennifer kind of mentioned about, you know, if you like something, comment on it or whatever, and you'll get more types of connections that way. I think it's helpful to understand that it doesn't hurt to like something. And if you're particular about, you know, liking things that you're really interested in, then you'll get that kind of positive feedback, I think. Let's see. So there's another question here that basically says, how far in advance of your desired start date do you advise turning on the open to work banner?
I do want to make a quick note on that because I didn't say it on the slide. So Jim, I don't know if you have advice in terms of timing, but I will say that when you do turn that on, if you're in a position, maybe you're not transitioning, right? You're already in a career and you're looking for the next step. LinkedIn does give you some visibility options on turning that on, but they're pretty clear that it's not foolproof. So I guess in terms of timing, it depends on where you're coming from, but I do want to point that out, that it's not super private. So if you're not in a place that you care, that you're if you're not in a place where you're ready to let an employer that you currently have know that you're open to work, I wouldn't leave that one on. But Jim, in terms of advance, I'll throw that one to you.
2 to 3 months. Realistically, a large company like us, the days to fill from the time we actually post an open job to the time we actually have the person start, it could be 60 days in some of our positions. So I think beyond 3 months, you're probably going to miss out on opportunities. But if I'm engaged with somebody and they tell me I'm available to work, you know, February 1st, that's close enough. You know, if we have an open position, we can probably be flexible, bridge to February 1st. If you're telling me, yeah, I don't transition out until next June, way too far in advance in most cases.
Oh, that makes sense. I think that those are the major questions we had. We have a few other kind of ones that I think most of were answered as we go through. Maybe I'll ask Jennifer real quick. Being someone that transitioned, you know, have you seen LinkedIn help your brand? And I mean, obviously we landed you here at ACP, so we knew what we were doing. But talk about your experience using LinkedIn.
Sure. No, I'm happy to. First, one of the things I wanted to kind of echo with Allison is that, and Jim, is that you don't have to build it overnight. You know, it's a process. It's ongoing. You know, and it's also cumulative. So every little thing you do every day adds up, you know, over time. So that's what I did, but mainly because a friend of mine kind of strongly suggested I start building my network 5 years before I retired. So my advice is the same. Don't build it when you need it. You know, you should start now and start taking steps. And also, it's okay to connect with other military people. But my friend was like, hey, what are you doing? You have no one outside of your military bubble. How are you supposed to make connections in the, you know, the civilian world, which was an excellent point. So I started reaching out to people outside of my immediate scope, right? And also I just started posting about things that I was interested in, and then also things that I was learning. Like when I learned something great, I love to share good information. So I would post it. Hey, I learned these great tips. You know, I learned about earning certifications. I learned about interviewing, resume writing. I'm still sharing stuff like that because it's still a mystery to me somewhat after, you know, so many years. So I'm always sharing good information. So it could be things that you're learning. And if you share the wealth, it's amazing what comes back to you. People come request connection requests, or if you're looking for something in particular, I think it's really important to not be shy and say exactly what it is you want, because if your immediate connections don't have that, they might know someone who does. And so it's amazing that when you put it out there, what will come back to you. So it's just a little bit every day, sharing what speaks to you, and then not being shy to reach out to people who have different experiences.
Great.
Yeah, don't be shy. I'm going to abridge my last answer just slightly. On the banner, you know, to me, the open to work is 3 months. But I have an example. I think last September, a woman contacted me on LinkedIn. I had no idea who she was. She sent me the message roughly saying, I'm on my last deployment on an aircraft carrier. I'm getting on it in like 2 weeks. I will transition out in April. I hear you may hire someone like me. You know, could we talk? That was last September. And that was very specific. It was very much targeted to me. And yeah, we love hiring. I think she was like an E4 Navy nuke maintenance tech. We love that profile. We started talking, and yeah, she got off the boat in March and started with us on April 1st. We already had it locked. But that wasn't a broad message to the world. That was a, don't be bashful, as Jennifer said, be real exact in what you're asking for, and you can hone in on some great opportunities.
Great. Well, as I think learned a lot is that I think there's, I've read that there's 85% of people get jobs by kind of having some sort of network connection, right? And I think LinkedIn is a huge multiplier of that, as Jim has used several examples throughout this, that, you know, someone just reached out to him on LinkedIn and, you know, lucky enough they get a job a few months later or whatever. So and they don't even have to be that strong. They don't have to be, you know, your brother or sister or something. I recommended you for a position. It just could be something like this. Hey, I saw you on the LinkedIn Live, ACP's LinkedIn Live, thought it was a great webinar. You know, this is what I'm looking to do. And that might be enough, right? So especially Jim's always looking to hire people. So everybody on here, contact Jim. No, this is great. Hey, this was a great webinar, everybody. I really appreciate everyone's input. So thank you so much for this today. And I think it'll be helpful for people to watch time and time again to get a better idea on getting a leg up for their transition. And for everyone out there, we just want to let everybody know, if you want to support ACP in any way, you can recommend us to a friend to be a protege. You can, if you're out there and established and you think you can be a mentor, please sign up to be a mentor. You know someone to be a mentor. Both of those things could be done on acp-usa.org. And we have a new fundraiser that's kind of starting this week with the Army-Navy football game as kind of the backdrop. So we're kind of starting a competition to raise money to help, hopefully help another 250 veterans or military spouses. And if you feel so inclined, you can donate. The link there is at the bottom of the banner. But we have a short URL that's armynavy.acp-usa.org. We'd love to have a little bit of addition to help more and more people. So thanks again today, everybody. We really appreciate your time, and we love our travelers relationship. So have a good day, everybody.
Likewise. Thank you, folks.
Bye. Bye.